I'm Vinod, so I have around 15 years of experience in this IT industry, and I run and manage this company. So going back to my experience, I have worked as a system admin for almost 7 to 8 years on Linux, on Windows, and then on the AIX, HP, Unix, Solaris, and later last 7 years I moved to storage. So we are currently, I worked in storage for CSC, IBM, and then Chrysler. And later on we started this company, and as of now we provide a large solutions where we sell all kind of storage, EMC, Hitachi, HP, Dell, and we provide a solution to customers around Hyderabad, and as well as we have office in Pune. So let me just give you that know what is that we are going to cover in this module. So now to learn storage, as you know, if you want to buy a car, so there are various variants of car available in the market. So you need to learn, you go to the driving school, if you don't have a driving experience and you learn a car. So you might be learning the car in the Maruti, but you might be buying a Tata car, right? So similarly, we have a various manufacturers of storage, and the manufacturers are, as you know, EMC. We are number one brand. Then you have an NetApp, you have a HP making the storage, Hitachi, Dell, Oracle, and various other brands are there. So there is a high competitive market among the storage. So if you learn one storage and you know one storage, then I know the other storage are also going to remain same, more or less same. So you don't have fundamental difference in the storages. Only thing is that the software and the way it works, that might differ to certain extent, but not overall perspective of the storage now will change from vendor to vendor. So to learn that storage, I will just tell you that how we are going to take it forward. So let me just open one notepad and give you how we are going to cover this module. So we are going to take you first week, okay, we will talk about your information in storage management, ISM, okay. So ISM is a purely around 6 this practical. So what does it teaches you? It teaches you fundamental of storage. We cover the fundamental of storage, like you any because you want to buy a car. So which brand you are buying, it doesn't matter, but fundamentals of car you are learning. So fundamental of storage is being covered in this, and we are going to talk about what are the different types of storage, what is SAN, what is NAS, and the different protocols, FC protocol, IP protocols, and the other FCOE protocols, new protocols in the market. What are the changes in the cloud computing, big data? So those fundamentals we are going to learn in the first week, and then in the second week we are going to learn about your what is it called, your EMC EMC SAN architecture. That we'll learn the architecture, and then we will learn about your RAID concepts. RAID concepts, you will learn how to create RAID groups, and also second week onwards you see there is a practical available on the storage, so we will talk about that. And third week we will learn about your different integrations for of EMC with Windows, Linux, VMware, right? VMware, that you learn. And fourth week also learn about the advanced topics and storage that we will learn. So we'll talk about how does the, we'll talk about a mirror view, we'll talk about a recover finds, snapshots that we'll talk about. So this is how we are going to cover these modules, okay. And for you, labs will be available over the internet, like we'll give you a VPN access, you will be able to do the labs. We'll also provide you a lab assistant who will be guiding you, assisting you in doing the practicals. So that is how we are going to cover this module of storage. So let me know if anyone has any questions, then I would like to address you. So today being the first session, or you call it as a demo session, I will just cover the fundamental part of the storage, okay, and then Chandra will send you, or might have sent you the course curriculum and the other details, right? So let me know if you have any questions now before we actually begin into the module. Anyone? Mani, Pradeep, Praveen? You can even type your questions also.
Yeah, and hello?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, this is Pradeep. You are telling about total 5 sessions, no?
No, no, total will be covering you 4 weeks. Chandra, can you throw the light on the number of days you have communicated to them?
Okay. This should be non-working days, Sunday, Saturdays or working days?
This should be non-working days, Saturday, Sunday.
Okay, okay. Okay, thank you.
So, any other questions you have? Praveen or Mani?
No, not much from my end.
Okay, so can we begin the session? Can we take a introduction to storage and ISM part? Can I take it?
Yeah, please.
Okay, thank you. So let's go ahead. You can raise your hand if you find, you know, you need to put some question. You can raise a hand in the webinar. So let me just take you. So, you know, we'll talk about a storage. Okay. So I want to start with introduction to information storage. So, you know, this module I want to talk about, we should define the data and the information and describe types of data. Now, evolution of storage architecture, the core elements of data center, and the characteristics of data center, and overall view of virtualization and the cloud computing that we want to talk about. So, now, what is data? So, what is data? If I put you a question, what is data? So, how do you define data? Can anyone define me what is data? Can you define me what is data?
Yeah, the collection of information where we can store. Hello, this is Pradeep.
Yeah, Pradeep.
Yeah, the collection of information.
The collect
any kind of information like human data, or machinery data, or software, something.
Okay. Assume I'm an intermediate teacher and I give you a data. I collect you all the data of the intermediate students and give it to you on the paper. So can I call this as information? Can I call this as information? Guys, I would like to...
Yeah, this is information.
Information, yes. Okay. See, listen to my question again. I'm an intermediate teacher. I collected all the required information of name of the student, their phone number, the email ID on a paper in a notebook, and I give it to you. I give it to Mani or Pradeep or Praveen. I say this is data. So can I call this data as information?
Yes, yes, this is data.
Okay. This is data, but this is not information.
Yeah, you already captured information, give it to me data.
Yeah, so we can call it as a data, no doubt, but we cannot call it as a complete information, because today I told you that I am going to give you on the paper. So in paper I am not able to cut and paste the phone numbers and I am not able to cut and paste the email keys, right? So I may have to, if I give you those data into an Excel sheet or into some database format, no, where there is a rows and columns and you are able to pull out the information at your fingertips, like all the phone numbers for bulk SMS or email IDs, no, then I can call this as a information. So you can very well relate that, no, information is related to data. So you can call information is the knowledge which is derived from what? Data. The teacher has given me the list of all the students, and I can put those data into an Excel sheet. I can call then it is the information. So if you look at today, any business model, no, be it a florist or a all a mall or any restaurant or anybody or any grocery shops, everybody wants to use a digital media to store the information. So growth of digital information has resulted in information explosion. That means, no, digitalization has resulted in the information explosion. Everybody wants to put the data into computer so that it can be used. So I understand you agree that now today you live in an on command and on demand world, right? We need information when and where required. So today you don't wait for today you don't wait for the information. Today you don't wait for the information. You browse the information at your fingertips. You want to know what are the bus service available from Hyderabad to Bangalore. You'll immediately go to redbus.com or any other bus services or any other website which is going to fetch you the data, right? So you live in a on command world. You can't wait for the data. That's the kind of speed at which you're looking for the data. You want to find out a doctor, best surgeon. You immediately go to Google or some doctor website, try to find out the information, reviews, you try to find out. So these will be there. So the dependency, increasing dependency on fast and reliable access to information. Right? So we need information when and where required. Increasing of dependency. So dependency on access to information is much more. So much more, okay, much more. So that is very, very important here. No, people rely on the iPad or rely on the mobile to access the information. Even banking, to booking of ticket, to booking anything or buying articles, Flipkart, Snapdeal. If you look at any business today, it is all about information. It is all about information. Okay, so. And that is very important. That is very important. So that is why the growth of information has happened. So all these business industries, they need data to be stored, to be protected, to be optimized, and to be leveraged. For example, let us assume that Praveen is a movie freak guy. He has stored all the movies. So it is that he says, I have a 400 plus movies in my kit. No, that store is not the only information. He need to protect it also. He need to optimize. That means if I say, look, I'm looking for a thriller movie, a romantic movie, he should be able to give me immediately. He cannot keep all the movies at one place. So data has to be stored, has to be protected, and has to be optimized. Okay? Has to be optimized. That is very important. That is very, very important. Okay? So business seeks to store, protect, optimize, and leverage the information to gain competitive advantage, to derive the new business opportunity. So everybody wants to exploit the data. Okay, that is very, very important aspect of the data management today. Right, very, very important aspect of data management today. So data is very, very important. Okay, let us see what else we can do with the data. So you can say, you can define the data as it is a collection of raw facts from which conclusion may be drawn, right? So so that is very important. See, what is the data, how you can define? So data, you can say that it is a collection of raw facts from which conclusion may be drawn. I said I am a teacher, I will collect the data and give it to you. And what is that you can look into those three papers? You can look that, okay, these are the name of the students who have passed out intermediate, and you can draw a conclusion that this is the data of passed out students of 2014 and 15. So raw facts from which a conclusion may be drawn, right? So that we can say, that we can say data, right? Data is converted into more convenient form, that is digital data. right? Everything he wants to move, everything he wants to put into the digitalization. What are the factors for digital data growth? Okay. One second. One more guy is joining. I'm just pass on to Chandra. Chandra, you are there?
Sir.
Hi, Chandra.
Yes, sir. Please tell me.
Chandra, I'll send you one mail ID. Can you just pass that link, webinar link, to one more?
Great, sir. I'll be doing it.
One second, Chandra. Sorry, guys. I will take a. Can you put me on mute? It should not be recorded. Just a minute.
Okay. Yes, sir. I kept you on mute.
Yeah, so guys, I'm back. I'm sorry. So let me go back to the example. So data is converted into a digital format. So today, if you look at a movie, no, you say, hey, Salman Khan movie has become a 100 crore hit in a 1 week time. How is it possible? Can you guess how it is possible? Can anyone of you can answer my question that, no, how the movies are becoming a 100 crore in a in a 7 to 10 days of time? Pradeep, Praveen, Raghu, Mani?
Yeah, it is digitalized and it is shown through DTH.
Yeah, it is shown through DTH. That means earlier we have, if you look at into the picture, earlier you have a reel, you know, and movies are being placed in the big towns and then it goes to the small towns like Eluru or Rajahmundry. But today movies are being launched across the city in multiple cinema halls, across the state, even in a small town also. The reason is it is digitalized and we say movie within 20 days is 100 crore. That's the power of digitalization today, you know. Photos, you don't go to any shop where you print your photos, you know. You have complete digital frame. You take as many pictures as possible. Books, no, e-book, it is converted into e-books. Now Ministry of Government of India is launching MOOC, Massive Online Courses. No, degrees will be available online. No, that shows that, no, how things are digitalized. Letters are converted into emails, you know. People, the number of mail letters they are writing and today how many emails they are writing, if you look at the ratio, no, it gives you amazing figures saying that, no, how the digitalization is happening in the market, right? And believe me, our country, you know, billion people, there is a much more growth to be available. We are not even reached 10% of what we are supposed to do. No, we are only digitalized in the big cities, not in the small towns and tier 2 cities. It is yet to happen. So the networks have not reached to the level. So the kind of growth we will see down the line 10 to 15 years will be huge in terms of data, right? So what are the factors which has actually increased the data processing capabilities? Right, so if you look at the factors, there is an increase in data processing capabilities. If you remember that 10 years ago the CPU processing powers were 1.2 gigahertz, 0.9, 800, 900, 1.2, 1.7, 2.1. Today we are touching 3.1. just in a massive 10 years we see multi-fold increase in the processing capabilities. Okay, So that's the power of the processing capabilities, you know, and lower cost of digital storage. Today, if you buy a 1 TB of disk, it is available for 4,000 to 5,000 rupees. I mean, local brand. And look at what communication technologies have changed. There is an affordable and faster communication technology. That means today you are able to communicate. Your desktops are lying in America and you can access from the iPad or from the mobile. Right? Your communication has improved. There is a 3G and we are talking about 4G. Right? And look at the kind of applications you have today. Proliferation of application and smart devices. We are talking about smart watches. See, I believe all of you, can anyone tell me what is the smartphones, number of smartphones around the world we have today? Can you just guess?
I can't give you the number, it's very huge.
But can you just predict what is the number of Android or maybe smartphones if I just ask you that? No, can you just guess what is that? Can you guess?
2 million.
Much more than that.
It's more than that. It's a trillion, I guess.
Yeah, just believe. Assume that now Pradeep is a fantastic guy who has a ability to develop an applications, right? And if you sign a contract with the Google or Play Store, and you can become an entrepreneur in a day times. That's the power of the communication today, you know. And you develop an application and which can be downloaded by a 1 lakh people across the world. You don't need a platform to start a company. Even if a price for you is a massive, you earn $1 lakh, man. $1 lakh is going to be around, you know, calculate the prices you are going to make. That's the power of application today. See, you storage admin or system admin, these are the things, but somebody who has a logic and can convert into an application, the kind of R&D and kind of applications we are seeing in the market, it's growing huge. It's growing huge. The relevant point here is for us that the applications growth is again leading to the data growth, and leading of data growth is nothing but contributing the cost of the storage. No, the managing the storage is going to be, has become so easy now, and the kind of growth we have in the storage sector. So that's the kind of strategy being followed, you know, proliferation of application and smart devices. The another league in the line going to be when you have a smart devices like phone, and we are talking about smart watches, and you believe that my smart watch is going to gather my pulse information, my blood pressure information, my overall health information. It is going to transmit to the hospitals where it is linked to. Hospitals can call me back saying that, look, Vinod, you have a temperature of 101, and can I? He can locate my area. He can call the nearest ambulance to pick me up. Can you imagine in a country like India or China, if these smart devices can be connected to the hospitals, which is ultimately going to happen the way smartphones have become popular today, you are going to generate a data, and that data will be very, very informative, and it is very crucial to manage our health. And look at the kind of storages each hospital would be needed. That will be massive. So I hope you understand the examples I have given you about the movies and photos, books and letters, and the applications which we talk about. Guys, feel free and just come me back if you have any questions on this. Anybody?
Yeah, okay. I got no more questions.
Okay, so let's move forward. And what are the two types of data you have? So on the screen you see the structured data and unstructured data. So Can shall I pick someone names? Yes. Raghu, can you, or Pradeep, Praveen, anybody, can you just classify me what is the structure and what is the unstructured data?
Yeah, structured data is something to do with more with the organization, based on the type of organization and the type of based on the organization you have different type of documents. Say if it is a healthcare organization, you would be more looking into the patient data and his own records. So if it is a structured data, it will be based on organization and it's sequentially structured. If it is unstructured data, example you are giving by here itself, ad hoc data what we get, and there is no relation between those data, it's unstructured data.
No, I didn't get it. Anyone else?
Yeah, Pradeep. Yeah, structured data is easily we can access, we can manage, and we can standardize. Unstructured data we cannot access easily, and we cannot maintain easily, and we cannot standardize easily. That is unstructured. Structured means we can easily access. Hello?
No, what do you mean by standardized? Easily access means what?
No, standardized means if you our customized related structure.
What do you mean by the customized data structure? How do you store data in computer? See, look guys.
In a simple way, you can say structured data is one which you can search easily. Okay,
easily.
Suppose you
where?
You can search your record.
How do you search easily? How do you search easily?
So, suppose structured data is in some database, okay, you can just write a query. Get the record.
You are right. Now I got the point. See, look, when you say structured data, that means it is stored in the rows and columns. So, what are the databases available in the market?
Oracle.
What are the databases available in the market? Can you
Oracle.
Name the database?
Oracle, SQL Server.
Oracle, SQL Server, DB2, MySQL. What else?
Teradata.
Okay, whatever, Teradata or something, right? So these
big
are
data.
The, big data is not that, big data is something different. So these are the database which you have in the market. That means when you store your data into rows and columns, no, it is a structured data. Like I have a 100 employees, I store the name and their payroll and date of joining, date of birth, and the complete class or something, I put in the rows and columns, either in the Excel sheet or in the database. Then those data are structured data. Can I put X-rays into rows and columns? Can I put X-rays or textbooks or manuals or images or pictures in the rows and columns?
No.
Can I put? No, I cannot.
No.
So, the only 10% of the data in this world are structured. Only 10% of the data in the world are what? The structured data. Only 10%. Right? So data can be classified structured and unstructured. The unstructured data are like your X-rays, your manuals, your images, your forms, your contracts, your email. In email, if I put my address, is it a structured? No, I'm just writing email, my address, Patrika Nagar, Madhapur or something, blah, blah, blah. No, it is not structured. You cannot pull out those informations. My messages, my document. Okay, so my documents, those are unstructured data. Instant messages, documents, web pages, rich media, invoices, audio, video. 90% of the data in these worlds are unstructured, which cannot be stored in the rows and columns. And the world has suffered a lot dealing with unstructured data. And all these companies of Oracle, IBM, Microsoft, they all have lost 30, 40 years we are struggling to make customers put the data into structured format, and it was highly impossible because the kind of growth which has happened to the database. And for that reason, we have something called big data today. Okay, for that reason we have something called big data today. So let me just make you understand that, no, what is the need of my big data? Look at the hospitals, the kind of images you have. Doctors are walking across the, you know, doctors are walking across the corner and they want to see the data. They don't want any more X-rays to be viewed in the kind of tube they have to see that. They all want to see online. That cannot be stored in the rows and columns. That is the one reason, you know, the world has surpassed that structured data and learned to manage the unstructured data, which can be stored in anywhere, emails or, you know, notepad or wherever you want to put this. So to deal with that, we have something called a big data. No? So what is a big data? Big data is something whose sizes are beyond the ability of commonly used software tools to capture, to store, manage and process within acceptable time limits. See, look at, I just want to clarify and give you one more example. I just open the Excel sheet. If I open an Excel sheet and I put a name here, I say I'll put a name and I'll say I'll put your date of birth, and then I'll put your date of joining, and then I put your address. These are structured. These are structured. I open a notepad and then I put the same data. I say ki it is a name, date of birth and date of joining and address. Unstructured data. Can I pull out this information? I cannot pull out this information. Yes, I can pull this information from here. I can just go and cut and paste this. I can pull the information. This is a structure, but when I store here, it is unstructured. The amount of data in this world are 90% of them are unstructured data. So the big data technologies is the one which can deal with the structured as well as unstructured data, which includes both. And variety of sources are the one which generate this both kind of data. So big data analysis in real time, they need the tools and techniques which can do a high performance, massively parallel processing data platforms and advanced analytics. That means today's environment, today's business environment, today's demand of the world, we need a analytics which will actually tell you the what is the right decision you need to take. If you look at an example of Snapdeal or Flipkart, the moment you go, they start following you. You open one page and you go to the news website, they'll follow you. Can you buy this? That's the analytics, you know. They know that you're looking to buy an online shoes from the market. They will follow you and they will do the analytics and know where you are going. They'll capture your IP address and they might send you a mail or that might send you a pop-up on the other screen. All of them are using the analytics today, and big data is having a bigger scope today, and we are expected to cross around 53 billion by 2019. That's the market size of the analytics we are talking about in the today's industry. So analytics can give you an opportunity to translate a large volumes of data into right decisions. Today ONGC wants to dig an oil in the rig. By using the analytics, I can find out that these areas, if I invest money and rig, what are my chances of getting an oil inside? Right? Education can use the big data analytics and can tell that if 500 people are being registered, what will be my opportunity to register 10% of the people by using analytics. A movie director today doesn't make a movie based on what is the concept he has in the mind. He analyzes the Facebook, Twitter, the LinkedIn and the different social media platforms to know that the last 3 months, whatever the movie is being released, what kind of masala story the masses like. And based on that, I can create my movie storyline. So today we have a analytics being available for the film industry to analyze the movie post release, so that I know that what kind of stories I need to make the movie to make it successful, commercially successful. We implement, and it's not being related to only one field. Across the sectors, we are going to use a big data technologies. I hope you are with me, guys. Do you have any question?
No questions, if you
want. We are good to go, guys?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So, that's a very small story I have given you. Please mute yourself. Chandra, can you mute the candidates? So, across the sectors, and there is a lot to talk about the big data technologies today. And let's go back and look into the storage and what are the different medias where we store data. So one, you have a media card in the cell phone or digital camera. You have DVDs and CD-ROM, which is outdated. You have a disk drives, separate disks. Then you have arrays. So what do you mean by array? Anyone?
The collection of disks.
Yes, collection of disks. See, if I have a CD case where I put a 10 multiple CDs in a case, I can say it is an array of CDs. So disk array is multiple drives. And we cannot write into the multiple drives at a time. So we need a storage platform. We need a software which can write into the multiple disks at the same time. So media card is used by the individual person in the cell phone. DVDs and CD-ROMs are so. Disk, yes, every individual buy a disk. Disk arrays, yes, companies which used to store a lot of data. So every individual in our life, either be a Ranjan or Adi or Raghu or Subrat Behra, everyone is contributing to the growth of storage today in the market. How you are contributing? We are contributing because each one of us has an account in the Facebook, has an account in the LinkedIn, has in Twitter, has a multiple email IDs. We are all contributing to the growth of this data. And companies like Facebook or LinkedIn or Twitter, or the Gmail account, they have to have a disk arrays to store this data. And then you also have tapes. Tapes are outdated. Year on year, 44% of the tape business we are losing in the market because tape is slow. Today you don't use the audio cassettes of tape anymore. No, we use MP3 or USB to go to the songs because they can be dynamically, they can access any songs from anywhere. I can read from anywhere. Whereas in the tape, you need to go in the sequential order. So these are the medias which are available to store data, right? And going forward, we are going to look into more detail about these drives, especially the disk arrays. And we are also going to see the architecture of the drives before. So let me take you to the next slide. Going back quickly to the history, earlier days you don't have a storage. Till 1990s or 80s you can say no storage. You buy a server, you have internal drives. If the drives are becoming full, you buy the next big server. If that is not sufficient, you buy this server. Right? So let me try to give you some pictorial representation on this. Let me see if I have a paintbrush I can use. Let me see. See, look at, I purchase one storage where I have a multiple drives and these drives are over. I will buy another server which can hold multiple drives again. And next phase, I am buying a much bigger server to hold the drives again. This was the story we see in the 1970s and 80s. You might not have been born, okay? And next, then we decided, you know, how long we are going to increase the server. So we then started buying the server, and we may have a one or two internal drives, okay? And then we started buying a JBOD, bunch of drives, or you can say the array of drives, a box which only contains disk. We started attaching them. This is how the evolution has happened. And then switching back here, then we have come to a conclusion that no, we need a centralized storage. We can't buy a storage for each individual. Look at, if I start buying the JBOD, bunch of drives for each server, assume in my company I have a 30 to 40 servers and 40 JBOD, what is my power bill going to be? Huge. And everyone will say, I need a 4 TB of storage. I may be giving to all the 10 different departments 4 TB of storage, and no, almost 40 TB I have given. At the end of the year, I find that no, hardly usage is going to be 10 to 20% of that. So for that reason, we then moved on to the centralized storage, where storage is going to remain a common. Okay, storage is going to remain a common, and we have connectivity to the multiple storage, and we allocate these storage on the need basis. On the need basis, right? So the idea was to make the storage centrally available, utilize it efficiently, optimize it so that we can reduce the cost. And that is where it has happened in the year 1998 we started doing this. I remember because I know those years I started my career. So that is where we see the storage being, you know, shared now. So if you look at, so we need to understand the data center. What is data center? So guys, I think you all know, being working in this industry, you all may be knowing that no, data center. So what is a data center? What is your definition of data center? What do you think that data center has? You see on the screen the core elements of data center. Anyone who would like to answer this question? Gopinath, Manikanta, Pradeep. Yeah? Who is answering this question, Raghu or? Please go ahead.
Yeah, it's Praveen here.
Yeah, Praveen.
Yeah, data center would be like a collection of your databases.
Only database?
You can have your application.
Yeah, if you look at the screen, kindly mute yourself. Thank you very much. If you look at the screen, you know, so let me just take you. So if you look at the screen, you have application. Application can be lying in the end user, maybe on your iPad or maybe on your mobile. Right? You have mobile, different application, maybe WhatsApp. So WhatsApp is an application which has a database to deal with. Whatever you're typing is being stored in the database. That's on the server in the America. So your application talks to database, right? And database can be Oracle, can be SQL, MySQL, or NoSQL, different types of database in the market. And application and database, they're all sitting where? On the computer host. And the server is only having a CPU to process your application, to process your application request. And the server is then finally connected to network, and via network it is connected to storage where your data is actually stored. So these core elements work together to address your data processing requirements. So if you, let me take you to the next slide. So if you look at the picture here, I'm a client, I'm using mobile or I'm using iPad or desktop. I may be connected to WAN, right, internet or LAN, local network. My application is WhatsApp, for example. You use mobile, you connect to the internet. Internet, you connect to the WhatsApp server. WhatsApp server is sitting wherever the location may be, on multiple locations across Asia and other continents. right? And then in server, your database sits, your application talks to database, where you have, do you want to clear or different kinds of options there in the application. And then that database is not sitting in the server. Server is only being kept to process the data, and actual data is being kept in the storage, which is connected via network to the server. And storage is being created or designed to have multiple fans to cool the storage, right? They have their own processor to process the request. So when end user requests the application to have the data, when you ping it, right, it goes to the server. Server then pull out your information from here to the server and then pass it back to the client. In a typical client server technology, this is how any application works, whether it is going to be on the internet, WAN, or it is going to be within the office LAN. Right? So the fundamental of your client server technologies are this picture. Right? So if you look at what is that I need to provide. So today when you talk about a cloud computing, is nothing but every customer used to have their own data center, but today they are available on the cloud. So when we say data center, so we need to protect this application, database, computer, network, and the storage. So if you look at the data integrity, how safe is the data? Security, availability, capacity to augment. No user says, give me another 10 TB, I should be able to augment that capacity. Scalability, how far I can scale. Performance, how faster I can access. And then ultimately it is going to be what? The manageability. So keeping these in the mind, my services are being offered. Right? So these are the characteristics of a data center. Right? So how do you manage this data center? So the data center management can be monitoring, reporting, and provisioning. So I gave you an example of how the health can be monitored. If you wear a smartwatch and if that can be connected to hospitals, I can monitor the health of the person. So how do you monitor the health of the servers, application, database, storage, switches, the various electronic equipments? So we have some monitoring agent through which you can gather the information on various elements, whether the CPU or memory is dead, or CPU or network card, IP address is down, power supply is up or not, fan is running or not. Every single individual unit can be monitored today. We talk about a smart grid, smart city. What do you mean by smart city or smart grid? That means everything is monitored through online, Internet of Things. Today we are talking about monitoring the transformer units being placed in your society or at your, at your colonies, at the plants. Every electronic device, machine to machine, can be monitored, has to be monitored through the Internet of Things. Then we can call it as a smart grid. I want to monitor my traffic data. Right? I want to monitor the traffic signals. I want to monitor the water supply. I want to monitor my electricity. I want to monitor my usage of computer. I want to monitor my usage of network services, my bandwidth, of internet bandwidth. Those, if they can be culminated together in a single dashboard, I can call it as a smart city. Reporting, how do you generate the report on this performance, capacity, and the utilization? Right? Provisioning, how do you provision these resources? So provisioning is the area where this course will be concentrated on. As a storage engineer, how do you configure and allocate the resources to meet the capacity, availability, performance, and security requirements? I think this is the area where your course is going to be dedicated to, provisioning. So the job of a storage engineer is to provide, to do the provisioning of configuration, allocation, maintaining availability, manageability, performance, security, integrity. And these has changed because of the two different technologies which has come to the market. One is virtualization and the cloud computing have changed the way data center infrastructure resources are provisioned and managed. I will throw some light on virtualization. There is a separate course available on virtualization and also as well as on the cloud computing. So if you remember your virtualization, no? So earlier we used to install only single operating system in your laptop or in your computer. But today, if you install a virtualization software, you can install 5 to 10 different operating systems in the laptop. No? If you put a VMware workstations, you can have multiple virtual machines in the same computer. You are sharing the resources. It's a technique of abstracting the physical resource and making them appear as a logical resource. No, resources are same, only you are segmenting them and you are sharing the resources. So by virtue of it, you are actually making the resource to be optimally used. For example, you have one disk, but you create a C partition, D partition and E partition, and then you store a different data in the same disk. That's nothing but virtualization. When you pool physical resources and provides an aggregated view of physical resource capabilities, that's nothing but virtualization. So what is the single point advantage of this virtualization is that it improves utilization of physical IT resources. Today, I live in a society. Today, there are 10 employees and I live in one single society, maybe a gated community, and we all travel to high-tech city or maybe Pocharam. 10 people driving a single car with 6 seats, no, I'm actually wasting my resources. And if you do a carpooling, no, I decide that now I will bring this car for 4 weeks or 1 week, and 5 people sit in a car together, so 2 car I'm using instead of 10 car. That's nothing but you are optimally utilizing the resources of your petrol, of the engine, of the seating capacity. In a similar way, if you use a virtualization software, your virtual resources can be created from pooled physical resources, and that will improve the utilization of physical IT resources. Right? So last 5-7 years, virtualization has been a key factor, you know, in every sector, and still the number of virtual machines in this world are much more than the physical machines available, you know, and that is also, I'm talking about a span of 6 to 8 years. Nobody know about the virtualization 10 years ago. We are only talking that next technology is going to be virtualization, and today we are talking about the next technology is big data, and maybe down the line we'll see something else coming into picture. And ultimately, one deadly blow has been the cloud computing. Every small company used to buy the laptop, server room, data center, and a lot of money they're spending. And after 5 years, this all hardware are becoming old, and then I'm moving to a new hardware. Right? But today, you don't need to purchase the hardware. You only need to have your iPad or computer. Your servers, you can lease it from the cloud computing. You don't need to buy, and you need to pay as per your use, like you are paying your mobile bill. You are paying 99 rupees for lifetime activation, and you are paying per use, pay as use. In a similar way, companies can take the servers from cloud, which will enable individuals and organizations to use IT resource as a service over network. I'm not buying, I'm using it as a service. And it can enable your self-service request, automate the request fulfillment process. I will say, I need only 500 GB of hard disk, this much of CPU, 2 GB of RAM, and I can cut one virtual machine, automate. And if I'm not using that virtual machine on Sunday, my bill will not be generated. There will be a monthly bill, and based on the usage, the bill will be generated. No? Water meter can be handled like this, your gas can be handled like this at your home. So similar way, the IT as a service can be used in this way. It enables users to scale up or scale down the usage of computing resources quickly. My business runs from Jan to December. In Jan to March, my business is good. I will say, give me 4 GB RAM. I will be charged for 4 GB. And then post January, March, I will say my business till September is dull. I just need 1 GB RAM. I will reduce to 1 GB. My billing will reduce. Coming back to October, festival season starts and my business picks up. I say I need 4 GB now. You know, so what you are doing is you are enabling the consumption based metering. No, your customers pay only for the resource they use. So your bills will be generated, the numbers of CPU hours you have used, amount of data you have transferred, and the gigabits of data is being stored. Now, these are changing the agility, the way business happens today. No, so virtualization and cloud computing, these are the two ways through which we can change the way business happens in the IT world. Guys, you can raise your hand if you have any questions. Chandra, can you mute them? Can you unmute all of them? Any questions, guys? Any questions from anyone?
No, from myself.
No, okay, so this, yeah, please.
No, sir, no questions.
No questions. So we are good to go. So this was the first module, and then we want to talk about what is my data center environment. So this 5 to 6 chapters will be completely theory. Okay. So what we will do is that I'll hand over back to Chandra, and then we will talk about the disk structure in the coming classes. You see, we'll talk about what is the different types of disk structure. Your ESXi, we'll talk about the RAID groups, okay, and your videos will also come back. Your videos will be available on your LMS. Chandra will explain you about the LMS facility. That means